I will not talk so much about science, but more about the database and give you a little bit insight into the database, hopefully. So actually, the TRI database started in 2007. So this year we have 10 years anniversary. And I'm very happy that we can kind of celebrate this in this context. And maybe at that point it's worth mentioning that for 10 years it has been paid by the Max Planck Institute for Biogeochemistry in Jena. And it has become kind of a community tool. So in 2007, we started with a goal to develop a global database of plant traits to make the data available for trait-based approaches in ecology and vegetation modeling and make these data available. TRI is basically a second generation of data pooling because there have been large databases before which have been pooled from smaller experiments and data sets like GlobNet and other databases have already been there. And many of those were integrated into TRI. But with time also many direct, not pre-compiled databases made it into TRI. Today, it's about 329 data sets in TRI, 1,000 traits, about 100,000 species and 5.6 million trait records. This is the database that's actually at the moment available. We are currently working on the next version of the database and it will have more data. It's a global research network and here the green dots are the measurement sites that provided data for TRI and the red dots are the institutes providing these data. And what we do in the context of TRI is basically mostly a data harmonization work, I would say. First, we give for each data set some metadata about the data set. Then we put all the data into one consistent data model. Then we harmonize the taxonomy. We correct misspellings and so on. Then we do some semantic integration of traits and metadata. And this is not always trivial because plant height for one person is the height of the plant and for the other person canopy height is the plant height, but canopy height could also be the height of the canopy where of the ecosystem where the plant has been grown. In this context, it wouldn't be a plant trait. And so there is some some implicit meaning we have to disentangle and to try to integrate. Next, we harmonize metadata to characterize growth and measurements conditions, which is sampling location and sampling date, and exposition and maturity. And then next, we do harmonized traits. And we do this not for all the traits we have in the database, but for those that have more than 1,000 records. In this context, we standardize the units, and then we do some error correction. And actually, this is important in this context. Here you see the kind of in between TRI version 2 and TRI version 3, and there were new data in TRI version 3 that were not error corrected yet for specific leaf area. And you see here specific leaf area, and here you see the individual data sets that contributed SLA. And here these are error corrected, and these are not, and these outliers are simply misunderstandings of units. And this is easy to correct, and this is easily included then in the database. Then we do data complementation, which is if you have leaf nitrogen concentration and you have SLA, you can calculate leaf nitrogen on an area basis. We add this data to the database. Then we identify duplicates because some data made it into the database via several pathways and are more than once in the database. And then we identify outliers. Finally, we do some consistency tests, do some reformatting and caching for output so that everything is released to data requesters in one consistent format. So we started in 2007. And these are the data sets that have been contributed to TRI. We started here with a strong increase and then ongoing contributions. We set some deadline here, but then always data came in. And we have a constant flow of data sets into the database. This is the number of requests. And actually, in 2015, we opened the data to the public. Before it was, if you want to use data via TRI, you have to contribute. But now is you can use the data via TRI, you only have to submit a request. And these are the publications using data via TRI. And actually, this here was kind of not expected, but to be able to do this, we had to change the whole interface around the database substantially. And I would like, and this is going towards the TRI website, and I would like to show a few aspects about this. And I see, hopefully, it works. First, if you go to the TRI website, you see the data portal. You can go to the data portal if you're interested in data, if you're interested about the history and everything else, you can read elsewhere, but if you're interested in the data, you go to the data portal. First, there's the opportunity to explore the data, and there are different ways to look at it, but the most informative if you just go to the trade table, and you can see then information for each of the trade, how many records there are, and how many species, and how many georeferenced data. Next, once you have explored the database, you would probably, maybe you would like to get some data. And this, we recommend to ask for traits and species. So you are interested in several, in a certain traits, and for some certain species. And we do not so much recommend to request traits by data set, because then you have to request many, many, many different data sets to get all the trait information which you are interested in. So if you request by trait and species, then there is a little introduction. You continue. You have to accept the intellectual property guidelines. You continue. Then you just select the trait. And here you can, again, look at the trait table. You go back and you kind of are interested in leaf area, which is trait number one. It's easy. You continue, and then it's shown to you, OK, you asked for trait number one, leaf area. That's fine. And then you continue to a species list, and you are just interested in one species. And for this example, I will choose species number one. And you continue, okay, this RR, it's a genus, RR, and not defined species. However, just for this purpose, we go on. You give a title, we say it's test, and then description for the new phytologist symposium. Here, these are the traits, these are the species you're interested in, and you continue, and now the request has been saved, and we continue to the next one. You add some co-authors. If you have some co-authors, we don't in this moment. And now it's calculated how many measurements you will request from TRI. In this context, we only ask for one species. There is no measurement, so it doesn't really make sense to continue. but if there would be some traits, then we would just continue here, select if we want to have public data only or public and restricted data, and submit. And that's it. And then you will receive the traits. It's very easy. And that's why probably also the number of requests has increased so much. So, but then after you have requested data, you will have a representation in the requester center, which is also here in the data portal. And this helps you to deal with your request. And actually, by the end of the day, you can choose, you see which requests, these are my requests to, and most of them are just for testing. But then there is this one, it's a serious one, and download data, request summary, it's here. I already downloaded the data. And here you can see, this is this one, and here you can see which co-authors, which data contributors to your requested co-authorship if you use these data in a publication. And I think this is a really nice help because you don't have to keep track of this all the way from today you request the data, in 4 years you do the publication. Maybe you have forgotten. It's in your requester center. So that really, I hope, helps a lot. Then the next thing you could think of is maybe contribute data to the database. And this is also now via the website and is basically pretty simple. And then you have the Dataset Custodian Center. And here you can kind of manage your requests, your data. And you can have a look. You can manage your data sets. So you can change the permissions, if they are public or if they only restricted. And you can have a look at all the requests that asked for your data. So you will see, and these are the requests asking for my data in the TRI database. So you have a list of all the requests that used your data. So, and I think this is helpful for the community. Then we recently developed, apart from the TRI database, a file archive, which is just a repository. And here you can provide data sets, and we are able to provide a DOI for the different data sets. These will not be stored directly in the plant trait and in the TRI database, but they will be downloadable as one file at this place. And if you haven't published the data yet in another context, you can do this here, and we can provide a DOI. And these can be public, but also restricted. And so this is a kind of opportunity to publish data which are so far unpublished. So with this, I think I will, return to the presentation. So this is the way you can provide data to the TRI database, but this was also the way you can request data from the TRI database. And we harmonize the data and we make these data available. Apart from this, we are involved in a number of ongoing projects to provide some data products based on the trait data in the TRI database. One data product is the gap-filled trait matrix, it's a gap-filling method, and we do have the gap-filled matrix at hand. It's not available kind of via the website yet because it's a kind of, so far it's just in developmental stage, this thing. But apart from this, we are involved in the development of global trait maps, and these maps will be available. And species mean traits from the Diaz et al. Paper here in the global spectrum, these species mean traits will become available also soon. And then I mentioned that we do versioning of the TRI database. After 10 years, we are now with the version number 4. And this will have more data, 6.9 million trait records for 1,800 traits and 140,000 taxa. And this higher number of taxa is because we are now able to use the plant list as a species backbone, and we do this via the taxon name resolution service. And we can resolve also not only species but subspecies. And so now we have about 140,000 accepted taxa in the TRI database. Then we do have an improved representation of root traits based on the FRET database in the TRI database. And actually, and this is now the last point here, we applied the thesaurus of plant characteristics to do the definitions of the traits. And in the thesaurus of plant characteristics, we already applied the definition that Luke mentioned about between absorptive and transport fine roots. So, and we did this in the context of the FRET database, where actually these data are available. And the development of the thesaurus of plant characteristics was in collaboration, or was headed by Eric Garnier, and it's an online tool that can be used to, and it's meant to be a community tool to develop definitions for plant traits. And every trait will have such a definition page where there is a name here, leaf area. And actually, when we developed this thesaurus, we came to the conclusion that a trait is the characteristic of an entity. The quality of an entity. A trait is a quality of an entity.
And what's an entity?
What? An entity can be basically anything physical. Yeah, no. Yeah, but your question is good. Luke just explained that from his viewpoint, the appropriate entity, and if you talk about fine roots, is not the fine root, but either the absorptive fine root or the transport fine root. And then the fine root, the absorptive fine root, or the transport fine root, that is the entity. Or the leaf is the entity. The entity can also be the whole plant if it's just for growth form or something like this. But this, what is the entity? And actually, if you take this kind of concept in a broader context, then you can also have ecosystem traits. Then the ecosystem is the entity. So every trait in the shall have such a definition. And the figure in the publication by Eric I like most is actually this one, which shows that three key aspects that are necessary to disambiguate a trait measurement. First, it's the definition, which is here a trait is a quality of an entity. You have to define the quality you are measuring, and you have to define the entity on which you are measuring. Then it's necessary to have a good protocol about what you have been doing. And this comes back to Belinda's kind of stomatal conductance can be anything. It can be open, can be closed, and so it's not a trait. Well, I disagree fundamentally, because once you know the environmental conditions that controls the stomatal conductance, and these are given with the protocol, then the stomatal conductance you can measure is definitely a trait from my point of view. And then we need some standard units. So yeah, no, of course not. But and actually, these protocols we started with the community started with the handbook by Hans Cornelissen, and we have to continue this to get towards some agreed kind of protocols for measurements and for metadata we provide with the traits. So with this, basically, I would like to finish. And just mention that I would like to get some feedback where the community would think the TRI database could move on most preferably to serve the community best. And we have a few open issues, because actually we request that if you use data from a data set that has been contributed to TRI, via TRI, that the original data source has to be cited. It's often above limits of the journals. So you easily have 50 or 60 or 100 data contributions you should reference, and the journals have a limit of 50 or something more or less. And so often this cannot be followed. But I don't see anything we can really do. I hope the journals will change their kind of approach to this. New phytologist somewhere here. I don't know.
We do actually try to include ensure that all data that's cited and supporting information is subsequently indexed. So that's something that we try to do. But we're sort of restricted in terms of what Google Scholar will index and what Web of Science will index. But we do ensure that all references that are cited are included in supporting information.
Yeah. And this is the key point, that it should be found by Google Scholar and these things. And this is ongoing development. There's a much movement at the moment in this context, right?
Yeah. As a journal, we canvass both Web of Science and Google Scholar to get them to index all references and supporting information. So as individuals, if you can do that too, that would probably help. So.
Next is the data availability and the whole scientific community moves towards open data, and then there would be a kind of question, should all trade records that are in TRI become public after some time they are in TRI? So let's say, like, you contribute data to the TRI database, and first it's still during your PhD or postdoc time and you are still working with the data, so you want the data to be restricted, but after 5 years or so, you have finished your PhD, you don't really use these data so much anymore, then these data could just move towards public. Unless you have a really strong argument against this. And maybe we can implement this in the guidelines such that this is also kind of written down. And then I think measurement protocols are much missing, because then we could have much more precise trade information. And then there are many unexploited opportunities like focused data collection, new data sources that are coming up, and maybe we can use the TRI database to identify gaps where data have been measured and where data should be measured in the future. So with this, I hope I didn't take too long, and maybe there are some questions possible still. Thank you very much.